Welcome to the live service from Family Worship Center in Athens, Tennessee. We pray this program will be a tremendous blessing to you. Now, let's go live into the sanctuary.
This morning.
Amen. Don't we need his presence? Amen. We can't go a day without it. Amen. Hallelujah. Are you awake this morning? It's awful quiet. Amen. Let's do this verse one more time. Amen. Let's just praise, lift our hands and praise him. Amen. He is worthy of all the honor, God. We lift your name up on high, God. Feel the winds of your love. Feel the winds of your spirit.
Thank you.
clap of praise. Amen. Whatever you have need of, God's got it. Amen. Amen. He's in control of everything. Amen. Yes. And it's to Him be all the glory. Amen. Let's Amen. Give Jesus one more hymn of praise and let's praise Him this morning. Amen. He is alive and well. We have no reason to sit around and just pity party. We have a reason to get up and go on in Jesus' name. Amen. The devil may be fighting you and try to hinder you, but something good's going to happen, and that's why. So just get up and keep going. Amen. Hallelujah.
Can you just believe?
this morning? Amen.
Amen. I think we got a few people on the battlefield. Amen. Praise the Lord. When you're in the Lord's army, you're on the front lines. Amen. You're on the front lines. You're not in the rear of the pack. You're on the front lines. Amen. Marching right straight toward the devil's camp. Amen. Amen. On the battlefield. It is a battlefield sometimes. Amen. It is a battle. You call yourself a Christian, you don't battle with demonic powers at times, there's something wrong with you. Amen. I said, if you don't battle with powers of darkness and the devil ain't trying to stop you, there's something wrong. You are not on the battlefield. Amen. But when you're on the battlefield, you're going to have principalities and powers and devils and people and everything you can think of come against you at times to try to stop you from serving the Lord. But amen, when you stay on the battlefield and let the Holy Spirit charge you up. Amen. Ain't no devil in hell that can take you off those front lines. Amen. All right. Well, if you have your Bibles this morning, go with me. And while the camera's on, go to 1 Samuel chapter 16. And I want to take a minute to thank those through the internet that are watching that have been given also for Africa. And we just thank God for what he's doing. And I thank God that the rest of the money we need is going to come in. I know it is. I know the Lord's moving on people. And we'll have it either before we leave or it'll still be coming in when we get back. We don't care. We take it either way. Tickets paid. We're on the plane, honey. So we're on the plane, and we got some other things going, but we gotta have the rest of the money to pay for some other stuff. So just believe that God's going to bring it in. He's moving on people, and he's going to touch people. 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 1. And the Lord said unto Samuel, that's what you need. You need a word from God. When you're going through stuff and you don't know what to do, you need to hear what the Lord is saying. And the Lord said unto Samuel, how long will you mourn for Saul? Seeing I have rejected him from reigning over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and go. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided me a king amongst his sons. I'm going to stop reading right there. And the title of my message this morning is Stop Mourning, Get Filled, and Go. Stop mourning, get filled, and go. You're never going to see the potential that God has for your life as long as you're sitting around mourning over your failures, over what others won't do, and your focus upon other people. You'll never be used in the realm that God wants to use you. You'll never see what God has for your life as long as you're sitting around mourning over your flesh, over your failures, over your sin. God doesn't want his church defeated by the powers of darkness. He don't want the church defeated by the devil, and he don't want you defeated by self. And I'm going to show you some things this morning that I think that's going to help some of us, that's going to correct some of us. I'll tell you up front, get ready for correction. Because the Lord is wanting his church to go forward. I said the Lord wants his church to go forward, his people to go forward. He wants to bring you out of the stuff that you're in. Amen. That's good news. But you can't get there unless you hear the word of the Lord and you yield yourself to what God wants to do. Let's pray. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. I thank you, Lord, for your word this morning. I thank you for the power of your Spirit, God. I thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in this church. I thank you, Lord, for what you're doing through those that are watching today, those that are listening through the internet. God, I pray that you touch them, that you bless them as they open their Bibles up. God, that you would enlighten them to your word, God, that you would open their eyes. God, that not what Thomas Climer says, but what the Holy Spirit is saying through your word, God, because your word is what we gauge our lives on. Your word is what we guide our lives by. And today, God, I'm asking you to let your word speak to us. Let it open our hearts this morning. Help us to yield ourselves to you and to submit to you this morning for what you want to do in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. I'm going to tell you what's going on here, because I'm going to go back through some of this and tell you. It actually starts this context that I just read to you really picks up in chapter 15. As I always try to tell people, you know, when you're reading the Bible or you're trying to learn about a subject, you don't just need to read one scripture. You need to read behind that scripture. You need to read ahead of that scripture. You need to get an understanding. You need to get a context of what is being said. Don't ever, as a Christian, just read one scripture and make you a doctrine out of it. Hello? You need to read behind it, you need to read ahead of it, and you need to search the scriptures to find out what it is that the Holy Spirit is trying to say to you, what God is trying to show you. But in the context this morning, you know so much of the story. The Bible tells us that Saul was the first king of Israel, but he was not really God's chosen, he was the people's chosen. So you get, when people start demanding that this is what they want, you never come out to the, when church starts demanding, we want this preacher and we want that preacher and we vote them in. Nobody's ever going to be happy. I wonder how many churches, like Brother Bobby said last weekend, right now they're without a pastor because they're ruled by denominations and religion, and they go a year, 2 years, and this pastor comes, and that pastor comes, and every now and then one will come and put his foot down and say, I'm going to preach the word of God, and he's the one that they really should be choosing, but instead they don't like him saying, sorry, you can't come up in here and tell us how things are going to go here. And when people put their foot down and say, I'm going to preach the word of God to you, they're not always accepted. So how many wonder how many churches they're without a pastor because they're the ones ruling the place, and they don't want to let God come. They don't want to let the Holy Spirit have his way, so they want to put in place who they want to put in place. Kind of like the election coming up. You just take a look at all this garbage going on. Look at the liberals. Look at this movement in our world. Look at this spirit that I don't understand this, and I'm not pushing one or another, but I will tell you, I ain't voting for Hillary Clinton, and I am voting, so I guess you figured out who I'm voting for. And we're going to get what the people give us. We're going to get who you vote for, my friend. You call yourself a born-again Christian, and you can't see the danger and the devil's rule in this nation through these liberal idiots that are seeking to destroy this nation, take away our freedom to preach the gospel, then you are blind. And we're going to get what we put in the office. You're going to get who you vote for, so you better know who you're voting for. But when it comes to the church, that ain't how the church operates. God don't send preachers through voting system. God calls preachers. He anoints preachers. And you got to take the one that God sends you, or you don't get the one God's trying to send you. You don't get no say-so. You didn't get to vote Brother Thomas and Melissa in, so you can't kick us out. And I'm glad you can't, because we'd have probably been gone a long time ago the first time some old long-tongued, backslidden, apostate, gossiping Christian don't like what God is trying to do in their heart. I'm glad today I'm not subservient unto men, but I'm a servant to the Lord Jesus Christ. And this church is established by God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost, and I ain't got to go anywhere. And you better know the devil don't like that. Oh, he don't like that. But you got what God has given. God sent us here for you. But Saul was, the people says, we want a king, we want a king, we want a king, we want a king. Have you had enough of Obama yet? Those, we want a president, we want to change, we want to change. You got the change you've been wanting, huh? But Saul, the people voted him in, pretty much. We want him. He's head and shoulders above other men. He looks good. He knows how to war. But the problem that you got with him is he just don't want to submit to God. He just don't want to let God have his way. I said he don't want God. But here's the thing I want you to understand. When Saul was instituted as a king, listen to this. Whenever he became king, the Bible tells us that God already through foreknowledge, God knew what was going to happen. So God through foreknowledge, he already knows what's going to happen. He'll work with what he has. And even with Saul, the Bible says he started off right, so to speak. He even, if you'll read the book, if you'll go back in the earlier chapters, I think it is, the Bible says that Saul even prophesied. He prophesied as the Holy Spirit came upon him. God would even use him at times. And when he became king, the Bible says he was little in his own sight. He was humble. And God started working with him. And God started using him. But you see, somehow position seems to start getting to men's heads. Position. 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 I ain't talking about just a presidential position. Position in a church. Well, don't they know who I am? I'm this, and I'm that, and I rule the roost, and I'm the elder, I'm the deacon, I'm the secretary, I'm the this, and I'm the that, and that position begins to go to people's heads at times. You see, that's why if you're going to serve God, you've got to learn how to let him humble you so that he can use you in the position that he desires to put you in. And Saul, he did start off right, the Bible says. But somewhere down the road, Saul's heart starts becoming hardened. And you see, here Saul is also a perfect picture of flesh. He's a perfect picture also of an apostate church that won't submit themselves to the righteousness of God any longer, but they're going about to try to establish their own righteousness. They have gotten off track somewhere. Okay, you could say Saul was saved 50 years ago. He started off good, but he died and went to hell. Because somewhere he got off track. His pride, listen, the Bible says, listen, it was his pride that got him. Well, I don't have any pride. You better go look in your mirror again. Pride. And so listen to what the Bible says. He sent Saul. Saul was commissioned. When Saul started out, listen, he was commissioned by God from Samuel the prophet. He was told as they were going into a battle, he was told God sent Samuel the prophet. When God wants to speak to people, he sends a man. He sends his word. He sends a preacher. He sends an apostle. He sends a prophet. He sends an evangelist or a pastor or a teacher. He doesn't use a politician. He uses his people. He uses the God, the called out ones. He uses the ones in the fivefold ministry when he wants to speak to people. And he was sent, after he was called, he was sent on a mission to destroy Amalek. Now, Amalek is a perfect picture also of the flesh. You see, when you and I get saved, whether you know this or not, when you accept Jesus Christ into your heart, God has commissioned you to go on to sanctification that you might see every single eye driven out of your land. You better hear me today. It ain't no once saved, always saved. Honey. That ain't the Bible I'm reading. God commands, he demands that you can't sit on a church pew and grow cold and bitter and weary and don't let him continue to work in, because if you do, you'll become prideful and you'll start thinking, well, them others in there, they might need some of that, but I don't need that. They need to go to the altar, but oh, God knows I don't need to go to the altar. See, our pride slips in. And he was sent by God. You better listen to me good today because I got a message for you today. He was sent by God just as every single believer today, God has told you to go on unto perfection. When I ain't perfect, and I'm sick and tired of hearing Christians use that garbage for not going forward. Well, we know you ain't. And I know I ain't, but I ain't going to use that lame excuse to sit around in my pity party while I'm rejecting the Word of God and not letting the Holy Spirit work in me and say, well, I ain't perfect, and God knows I ain't perfect. We know that, but the Word has told you, like Saul, go and destroy the Amalekites. The works of the flesh have to be driven out. Because listen, if they're not, the Bible says in Galatians 5, they will be manifest in you. They will come forth from your life, and you will become a hindrance to the work of God. Come on, somebody. I said you'll become a hindrance to the work of God if you don't let the Holy Spirit drive out the works of the flesh. So what this means is when you get saved, you ain't perfect. You didn't arrive. You didn't get everything you needed when you got saved. You just got set up for the process for the Holy Spirit to start driving some junk out of your land. Now I'm going to ask you today, has anybody been letting the Lord drive some junk out of your land? Are you just stagnant? Or you just come to church and sit on a pew and go through your religious motions? Are you pursuing after Jesus? Paul said that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. He said, I know I'm not perfect, but I forget the things that are behind and I press toward the mark. I'm reaching forward to more Christ-likeness. I want to become more like him. And the only way you can become more like him is you gonna have to die to your flesh. Woo! You're gonna have to let some stuff be driven out by the Holy Spirit. Listen, only by your faith in the sacrifice of God's Son and what he did on the cross. Otherwise, nothing's being driven out. Otherwise, nothing is being driven out. You're trying to change yourself. Yes, you are. And you can't do it. There has to be a full submission to Jesus Christ. Otherwise, you're left with self. Saul was sent on a mission to go, and he was told by Samuel the prophet, listen, God says this. He said, I remember what Amalek did to Israel. God knows what your flesh is doing to you. Now, God knows what you're letting your flesh do to you. I know what Amalek did to Israel, my church. And it's also a type of the world. God knows what the world is doing to his people. He knows what tares are doing to his people. He knows what's going on. But listen now. He said, I know what Amalek did to Israel, how he laid wait for him in the way, and he came up from Egypt. He said, now go and smite Amalek. Saul, this is your mission. This is given to you by a man of God, Samuel the prophet. Go and smite Amalek, listen, and utterly destroy everything that they have. I'm telling you this morning, I'm trying to go somewhere. You don't get to leave anything, honey. God says, the Holy Spirit says, everything has to go. He was told to go into Amalek to take out the women, the men, the children, the oxen, the sheep. Why? Because it was infected with sin. See, I know some of us, we don't see it today. We don't think that we are infected, but you infected, honey. You were born with a sin nature, and you're still corrupted by that influence, and there ain't but one thing that can get it out of you. It is the blood of God's Son, Jesus Christ, and you are to pursue after, you are to go after him, and let the Holy Ghost drive out your flesh little by little, piece by piece, however it is, let God drive it out. Utterly destroy all that they have. Do you know that Paul said when you get saved, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Well, if all things have become new, then how can we sit around and laugh at dirty jokes and cuss words and with people who are of the devil? Have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them, Ephesians 5:11 says. Hello. Well, how come the church acts just like the world? We laugh at their jokes. We laugh at their filth. We approve of it. And we think we're going to win them because we're laughing with them. You ain't winning nobody. You're a fool. You don't win the world by acting like the world. They got to see a change in you. If they don't see no change in you, honey, don't worry. They ain't coming to you for help. I said, if they don't see a change in you, that's why the message of the cross is so important, church, that you and I get in this process, that we don't let this just get in our head and we don't let it get in our heart. You got to let this message, you got to let, listen, the Holy Spirit permeate your very being and drive out the garbage that is in you. Because if you don't, you'll be sitting around laughing with them, joking with them, and joining in on what God says is blasphemy and garbage and pollution of the world. And listen to their music and drinking their alcohol. Come on, somebody. You ain't going to win people by acting like them. The works of the flesh have to be driven out, and it can't be done by you, but you are to pursue after the process by which it is driven out. Now listen, destroy everything they have. And listen, spare them not. When you got saved, you didn't understand this, but this is what the Holy Spirit said. You need to go on to let me continue to work in you, and you don't need to spare things that are still there. You need to let me get it out. You don't need to make excuses for it. Well, my mama, well, my daddy, well, my granddaddy. No, it's you. And you're corrupted by a sinful nature that ain't got nothing to do with your mama, your granddaddy, your pappy. It's you. And you've got to get in the process by which God, and you won't sit around and have a pity party and blame everybody else. You go ahead, but that ain't going to fly with God. God don't take those lame excuses, not in the face of light, not in the face of truth. The church can't be ignorant in these days. There's too much truth going out. Oh, no, there's too much truth going out. There's no reason for anybody in this church to be ignorant of what I'm teaching you. There's no reason for anybody to have to, well, I wonder if he's telling me the truth. I wonder, and you go home and you go, like the preacher said last week, go down the street and you talk to the other guy and you start trying to tear down your pastor. You know why you do that? Because you don't know God's word. You need to shut your mouth, get on your knees and start praying. Let the Holy Ghost open up the word of God to you and start showing you for your own self. Come on, somebody. Hello, and you don't have to, then you won't have to question everything somebody said. Look, if you're full of the Holy Ghost, you're letting God work in you, then your spirit is going to bear witness with what the Holy Spirit is saying, and you're going to know the preacher's right. He ain't just pulling this stuff out of space, but this is the word of God. We need people with discernment in the church. Oh, no, you know why we don't know? Because we don't open our Bibles ourselves. We don't get that. We say, I got an expository study Bible. Well, how much are you reading that thing, man? How much of the notes are you reading? How much are you pouring over saying, God, show me what, help me to understand this? I mean, in the face of rejection, we got the truth right in front of us. We got tools that can help be a blessing to us, and we still go on living in the flesh, blaming somebody else. But it's not going to fly with God. Now listen, he told them, drive them out. He told them to destroy everything. And that means all works of the flesh, they have to go. Why? Because everything was infected by sin. Our world, if you can't look around and see that our world is infected by sin, you can't see. The problem is sin, folks. It ain't a disease, it's sin. It's a sinful nature that people are being dominated by. And they can't be free from anything until they surrender their heart and life to Jesus Christ. And if you don't tell people that, you ain't going to get nobody saved. You ain't going to get them set free. You can say, well, come to the Lord, come to God, come to the man upstairs. But until you tell them to repent and come back and do your first works over, ask God to forgive you of your sins. Oh, no, we don't want to call nobody a sinner. I don't want to offend nobody. Well, honey, that's what they are. They're lost without God. And sinners got to be confronted. It don't mean
mean you be arrogant or you're holier than thou, but if you ignore their very problem, oh, well, you just go to the doctor. You need another counselor. You need another psychiatrist. You need another drug. Do you know what you're doing? And you telling me you know the message of the cross? No, you don't. No, you don't. Because if you did, you wouldn't be sending people to the devil. Woo! You wouldn't be sending people to the devil. The problem is, I'm going to tell you what the problem is in the church. It ain't nothing but pure stinking unbelief. You and I, some of us don't. It's been miracles work right before some of our eyes. We've seen God take people in our families, turn their whole world around, set them free, and we still don't even believe that that is really the power to save and to change a person. How rebellious, how stubborn can we be? It's unbelief. You see, unbelief, it breeds a spirit of pride. And we start sending people away. We send them away when we send them to the doctor and the psychiatrist and the program. We send them away when we send them to the world. We send them away when we send them to apostate churches. Church world is in a mess. Drive them out, he said. Paul said in Galatians 5:19-21, he lists all these works of the flesh. He said, that will be made manifest. In other words, they'll come out of you. Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of which I told you and I've also told you in times past. Listen, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. It ain't once saved, always saved. No, it ain't. If you call yourself a Christian and you are practicing these sins, drunkenness, idolatry, hatred, he's saying, no, you're being fooled. The devil's deceiving you. You will not inherit the kingdom of God if you go on allowing yourself to be ruled by the works of your flesh. Because the only way the works of the flesh can be dealt with is by faith in the blood of Jesus Christ. And if you don't get in that process, nothing's being driven out. See, everything starts at the foot of the cross and it ends at the foot of the cross. Listen. And so he told them to drive them out. So you know what Saul does? Here's what Saul does. Saul did what we do. Saul has given a command by God. Samuel's told him, go take care of all these. Drive them out. Don't spare anything in the land. Don't leave one work of the flesh there, but go on and drive it out. So the Bible says what Saul does, he partially performs the will of God. The Bible says he took Agag, Saul goes, he takes the king and the Amalekites alive. And then he takes the king and the Amalekites alive, and he utterly destroyed all the people with the edge of the sword. But Saul and the people spared Agag and the best of the sheep. See, you know what we like to do? We moral. We all up on people that drink and smoke and cuss and things we see outwardly. But how much stuff are the good stuff in us that we don't see as evil, but we think it's all good, and we think we're moral, and we think we can live by God, by keeping commandments, and we say, oh, I'm going to hold on to that because I'm good. I'm moral. I don't do what he does. God says, that's got to go too. He spared Agag, listen, and he spared some of the sheep that he was supposed to totally eliminate. Everything has to be wiped out. Is this hurting somebody's feelings this morning? Because if it is, it's good. Because you know what this says? This says you can't do it. This says you can't do this. I can't do this. I got to be in the process by which God drives these enemies out. That's why, you know, we need to hear this over and over. Because what we do, we want to get rid of all the vile stuff. But what about that hidden secret thing, stuff in the heart that can't nobody else? They don't know it's there because I got a stone in front of my heart. But the Holy Ghost knows it's there. And it manifests. I said it manifests. Somewhere down the road, your flesh is going to manifest. Whatever you're holding on to, whatever you're holding back, whatever you're refusing to let God deal with, it will manifest your pride. I ain't wrong. Ain't nobody going to tell me what to do. Ain't nobody going to correct me. I ain't listening to you. I don't care what you say. That's your pride. Because you can't take correction from God. Saul, I'm going to show you in the scripture, there's some things that happened with Saul. He didn't like it, but it didn't matter if he didn't like it. It was true. Now listen, he's told to drive it all out, but what does he do? He goes in, he destroys most of it, but he keeps some. That's us. We keep some. We keep some of our goodness. You just don't know how great and good I am. You don't know what I do for people. You don't know how I'm good. Well, listen. He spared all of the sheep, all the oxen and the fatlings and the lambs and everything that was good. You know what he was? You know what he was taking on? The spirit of Cain. The spirit of Cain. This comes to God and says, I don't need what you told my brother to bring. I can come to God myself. I can come to God with my goodness. I can come to God with my morality. I can come to God with my commandment keeping. I don't need a lamb. I don't need blood. I don't need sacrifice. I got my taters. I got my onions. I got my vegetables. I've worked real hard, and surely God is going to accept the labor of my hands. And people think they're going to stand before a holy God on a day of judgment, and they're going to enter into heaven because they were good. And Jesus is going to say, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I never knew you. I never knew you, because they think they're good. You're not good. You ain't good. No, you ain't. No, you ain't. There is no goodness in you. And if you think you're good enough to get to heaven, you're deceived. You're deceived. And you're blinded by religion. Religion is the worst deception of all deception. Because it makes a person believe something that is not reality. This is reality. The Word of God is reality. Jesus said that people are going to stand before him in Matthew 7, and they're going to say, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Did we not cast out devils? Did we not do good things in the church? And he said, depart from me. I never knew you. People are going to die and bust hell wide open thinking they're right with God because they did something good. He wants to keep the good. You can't keep the good. The good's got to go. The good's got to go. Your morality has got to go. Your self-righteousness has got to go. He would not utterly destroy him, but everything that was vile and refuse, he destroyed. Oh, the vile stuff. Ooh, that's evil and that's nasty. And them old drunkards and them old drug addicts and them old alcoholics and them old perverts and them old homosexuals. And we turn right around and are dominated by the same spirit that permeates them, that fills us with envy and jealousy and hatred and pride. Hello. We point our finger at a world and we are just as nasty on the inside, because we're nothing more than religious Pharisees. I knew this wasn't going to be no shouting message this morning. But I don't care if you shout me down or cuss me out. I'm telling you the truth. There's some stuff you're going to have to let the Holy Spirit drive out, or you're going to become a hindrance to the work of God, and you'll be removed out of God's kingdom. And you'll be removed out of God's work if you don't go on to let the Holy Spirit drive things out. You don't want to become a hindrance. Saul, he come to the place, he allowed himself to be ruled by the devil. To be ruled by the devil. He started off good. So many people start off good. So many people really do start off, they get saved 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. But something happens. Things happen as time passes. And they leave the foundation of the gospel and they go back out into a world. Or they can even sit in a church where the gospel is being preached and not showing outward signs, but inwardly they are like dead men's bones because they got the same spirit that they once possessed. This is a warning to us, church. We got to go on to let God drive things out of us, because if we don't, we can lose our way. You can lose your way. I don't care what some stupid Baptist church told you. You can lose your soul and go to hell if you turn your back on God and you take on the spirit of the world and you refuse to let God work in you, and you start drifting back out in this world. You go back to drinking. You go back to drugging. You go back to your former life. The Bible says you're like a dog that returns to his own vomit again, and your end's going to be worse than the latter. Your end's going to be worse than what you was when you started out. The backslider, the Bible says, when a person backslides on God, when they go back out in this world, they are worse. They are 10 times worse than they were before. Some of y'all don't understand, but that's what's wrong with some of your family. Because when you reject God, when you reject God's word, I'm talking about some of my own family, when you reject God's word, when you turn your back on him right in the face of truth, you become a worse devil than you ever were to begin with. Do you hear me? I've seen people, brother, that I've seen God start off working in, and something happened and they fall away from him down the road, and they go, Michael's got a testimony. He can tell you some things about his own life because of not knowing the ways of God, or maybe even some rebellion at the time. He can tell it better than I can. But he said when he went out, he got worse. Worse. You don't reject God's word and come away better. It don't matter even if you're ignorant. That ignorance ain't an excuse in the face of light. It's no excuse. God, when God gives light, you can't sit back and just be ignorant. I'm talking about in the face of light. If you don't have light, you don't have truth, then I can understand. That's a different story. But you don't come away better. You come away worse than you ever were. Now listen, I'm trying to get through this, and I'm not near through it. The Bible says, okay, what did he do? He disobeyed the Lord. And I'm going to show you what happens when any of us disobey the Lord. When God's told you to do something and you disobey, you think you're going to come out to the good? Do you think you're really going to come out to the good? So God's told this church, he's telling people watching through that internet, he's telling people that the works of your flesh can be driven out by faith in the blood of his son, Jesus Christ, but you sit there and you reject it. And you think that you're going to come out to the good. You're not. Well, how do you know who's rejected? How do you know people's hearts? How do you know what's going on? It's called discernment. It's called discernment. If you ignore the cross, if you refuse to take up your cross, if you refuse to deny yourself, if you refuse to take up your cross daily and surrender your whole life to Jesus Christ, you can stand in danger of losing your soul. This is serious. Because what happens is, you put your faith in something else, you don't have the power to control your flesh and your lust and your earthly desires, and things creep in and start pulling you away from God, and you don't have any power to overcome it because you're being led by your flesh. I'm telling you, the answer to that is to submit to Jesus Christ, place your faith in what he did on the cross, and don't just do it when you come in here on Sunday morning, but you got to do it on Monday morning. You got to do it on Tuesday morning. You got to do it on Wednesday morning. You got to do it on Thursday. Oh, now you're getting, oh, you mean I was depending on coming to church, and you take care of my salvation, Thomas, and you just get me through the rest of the week. Honey, if you're looking at me, you're looking to the wrong person. I'm here to, like Samuel was to Saul, to say, hey, you need to heed the voice of the Lord. You need to obey when God speaks to you and he says do something. Do it, because no matter what it is, it's going to have negative consequences if you disobey the word of God. Now listen. What does he do? He turns his back. Saul starts turning his back to God. He starts turning his back. You know how many Christians have turned their back to God? Because they're ignoring the only way that they can be changed. They're ignoring the only way that they can be changed. They're turning their backs to God. And it says, God sent a warning and told Samuel, said, it repents me that I set up Saul to be king. Said, he's turned his back from following me. He has not performed my commandments. And it grieved Samuel, and Samuel cried unto the Lord all night. See, this grieved this man of God, because this man of God, Saul may have been like family to this man of God, because this man of God played a part in anointing this king in the presence of others and asking God to lay his hand on him and to use him. So I would say that more than likely Samuel became close to Saul at the beginning when he saw what God was doing in his heart and in his life, and there was a fellowship there between them. But then when God starts showing Samuel that Saul don't want what he's trying to do in him, it brings grief to Samuel. Can I tell you what will bring more grief to this church than anything? Can I tell you what? I'm going to just be honest. I'm going to be a pastor to you for a minute. Can I tell you what brings more grief to Thomas and Melissa Climer in this church than anything? Grief. Oh, you mean you grieve, preacher? Yeah. You just don't know it sometimes. Here's what grieves us more than anything. When we know we have a message, when we know what God has done in our own lives and how this really works, and we stand before people and we tell them over and over and over how to be changed, and they just go right on about their lives like they never heard it, and no change comes in their life. That grieves me, but I'm going to tell you something. That's where I'm going with this. I'm over you. I'm over some people. I said, I'm over some people, and I'm going to tell you why. Because God knows when a person has come to the point to where they ain't interested in letting him work. And not only that, God will show his people. He'll show through discernment who really wants his will and who's playing church. Do you hear me? I said, God, I don't believe that. Well, I'll tell you what then. Let me read something to you then. He said, it grieves me that he's turned his back from following me. He's not performed my commandments. And it grieves Samuel to cry unto the Lord. He went and cried unto God all night. He's mourning. God, God, don't you remember? I mean, he started out good and this and that, and he's grieved. Why can't you just let him go on, God? Let him stay in the church a little bit longer. Let him go on and just let him, God, just give him another chance. And God says, no, I ain't doing it, because I know his heart. God says, no, I ain't doing it because I know his heart. And I'm going to tell you something, Samuel. I'm going to show you something, Samuel. Listen. Samuel rose early in the morning. Listen, he was up all night long crying unto God, and God showed Samuel something. See, when you get close to the Lord, God will show you something about other people. Did you hear that? It ain't for you to go around and call someone. It's to protect you. It's to protect you from their religious spirit. It's to protect you from rebellion. It's to protect you from following after that which is going in a direction that don't want God's word. Do you hear me, somebody? You better be careful who you're traveling with. You better know who you're traveling with in the church. You better know what spirit they're of. You better know what doctrine they believe. You better know if they believe in once saved, always saved. You better know if they believe the word of God or if they believe what some religious denomination told them. Now listen, he's up all night, and Samuel rose early in the morning. He gets up early. Samuel got up early in the morning, and he went to meet Saul. And it was told Samuel, saying, he said, Saul came to Carmel, and behold, he set him up a place, and he's gone about, and he passed on, and he went down to Gilgal. And Samuel came to Saul. When Samuel comes to Saul, now listen to this, he's been confronted. Saul has been confronted with his rebellion. He's been confronted with his refusing to carry out the word of the Lord. You see, God's going to confront you somewhere down the road. God will confront us when we're not going the way he wants us to go, because he loves you. So he's confronted. And when Saul comes to Samuel, here's what Saul does. He puts on this religious show. Blessed thou be of the Lord. He said, I have performed the commandment of the Lord. Religious people, blessed be thou. I'm so holy. I've done what God told me to do. Yeah, but you hadn't done all of it. And he comes to Samuel, blessed be thou of the Lord, prophet, man of God. I've carried out the commandment of the Lord. Come here and pat me on the back. Aren't you proud of me? But he don't know that the man of God has been talking with the Lord. And see, just when you think, oh, Lord, help me. He says, I've obeyed the commandment of the Lord. But Samuel said unto him, okay, if you've obeyed the commandment of the Lord, what means this bleating of the sheep in my ears and this lowing of the oxen? If you have destroyed everything that God told you to destroy and the works of the flesh are being driven out, he said, what's all this noise I hear? If you have really carried out the word of the Lord, what's this gossiping going on? What's this noise? What's this ruckus in the church? What's this rebellion and this backbiting, oh Lord? And people letting their tongues be used of the devil. If you're really letting the Holy Spirit drive out the works of the flesh, then guess what? Won't be any gossiping. Won't be any backbiting. Won't be any rolling your eyes at people you don't like in church. Come on, somebody. You can say what you want to say, but I'm telling you, it's going to come out. Boy, I know I'm hitting home this morning. I feel darts. If we really believe the message of the cross and we say we're submitting, then what's the noise? If we're carrying out everything God's told us to, what is all this noise? Samuel says, then why do I hear the bleating of all these sheep and why are these animals still alive? Then why is the old you still alive? Just think. This is a thinking message. This is to make us think. It ain't going to pass with, oh, I got a head knowledge of what Thomas preaches. Where's the heart knowledge? Where's the change? Come on, somebody. I'm not bringing a change. God is bringing a change. But I'm asking you, where's the change? So Saul said, here's what Saul said. He said, they brought them from the Amalekites, and the people spared the best of the sheep. It's their fault that the devil made me do it. That my family made me do it. My son and my daughter just did something so bad and made me cuss like a sailor. They made me do it. No, they didn't. That's what's in you, and that's why it's coming out of you. Come on, somebody. When you smash your finger, you find out what's in you. Yes, you do. When you get cut off in traffic, you find out what's in you. When somebody sticks a middle finger up on you at you going down the road, you find out what's in you. Come on, somebody. When your husband comes in and dirties up your clean house, woman, you find out what's still in you. Oh, yes, you do. It's going to come out. I don't want to hear your profession. Show me some possession. Show me some proof that the message is really working in your life. Show me some change. Come on, talk all you want to. I go to Family Worship Center in Athens, Tennessee. Glory to God, greatest preaching, greatest church in Athens, Tennessee, and it probably is. And then you go out the door and face family and a world and people whose lives need to be changed, and you act just like them. Just think. I ain't pointing fingers. I'm saying think. This is a reality check message, folks. It ain't, well, I know the message of the cross. Good. James 1:22 says, stop being hearers of the word only and deceiving yourselves, but be doers of the word. Because if you're just a hearer, you're being deceived. Because the Holy Spirit, when he's working in you, he ain't giving you just power to hear. He's giving you power to do. And then those who hate you, you'll be able to love them. You don't love their ways. You don't love the devil. You don't love evil. You don't love country music. You don't love rock music. You don't love alcohol. You don't love drugs. You don't love sex out of marriage. You don't love fornication. And if you do, and calling yourself born again, you're deceived. Deceived. I'm not talking about somebody struggling. Get me? Because I know people will turn right around and twist what I'm saying. I ain't talking about people struggling. I mean struggling. There's a bondage. They don't know how to get free. They're fighting against it in their own strength. I'm talking about people in the face of light who are not doing what they say they're believing. That's what I'm talking about. Listen. What's this bleeding of the sheep and lowing of the oxen? He said, they have brought them from the Amalekites. He starts blaming other people. I'm not going to go through that, but that's just like us. What do? We start blaming somebody else. God confronts Adam. He blames Eve. Eve blames the devil, and then everybody's just been blaming everybody ever since then. Nobody wants to take responsibility for their sin. I'm not a problem. It ain't me. I can't believe that you tell me I'm wrong. Listen, let me get on out of here. So listen to what happens. He brings all these sheep and says, we're sacrificing unto God. We save these sheep because we're sacrificing. We're saving our flesh and we're going to give it to God. We're saving the best. We're going to sacrifice it to God. We're going to let it be used. I'm saving my talent. I'm going to let it be used for the glory of God. God don't need your talent. He needs a surrender. He needs a full heart surrender. We're trying to save the good that the world says, you're good. God says, that's no good. That's your flesh, and it needs to go. If I'm going to use you, your flesh, he said, needs to go. He said, but the rest, we've utterly destroyed the rest of it. See, some of us, we pride ourselves. You know, we got rid of the drugs, we got rid of the alcohol, we got rid of the sexual immorality, and we think we're moral, but we don't see envy, we don't see jealousy, we don't see pride, we don't see I think I'm better than you are because I've been coming to this church longer than you have. We don't see that. But it's still there. Hello? I'm just being truthful this morning. You new people, just stick with me. Stick with us. Samuel said to Saul, he said, just stay on here. He said, I'm going to tell you what the Lord has said to me this night. Just be cool, Saul. I'm going to go to God, and I'm going to find out what God says about what you're doing. You think the preacher who don't pray for his church? You think the preacher don't seek God about who's who? You think the preacher don't go to God to find out what needs to be done in church, what needs to be handled in situations and circumstances? Yes, he does. Listen, he says, I'm going to go and find out what the Lord says this night. See, that's what we got to learn to do when we have problems. We got to go find out what God says. And when God says it, you confront the people. Come on, somebody. When God says it, you confront them. When a preacher is called to preach something, he finds out what God wants said, and he confronts the people. He preaches the gospel. That's the way it always works. And Samuel said, when you were little in your own sight, here it is, when you were little in your own sight, when you were humble, was not you made the head of the tribes of Israel, and the Lord anointed you king over Israel. When you were little in your own sight, when you came to Jesus Christ and he broke you like a baby and you cried a lot and you just was in love with nobody but him and all you wanted to do was tell others about what he's done in your life, you were humble, you were broken, or were you? Or were you? When you were humble in your own sight. See, when a man comes and surrenders his heart to Jesus Christ, when he kneels at the foot of that old rugged cross and the Holy Ghost fills his heart, he breaks him, he changes, he makes a brand new creation out of him. He's not what he used to be. And it's a humbling process to have to repent of all your sins and come to the one who can forgive you of every one of them. It's a humbling process. It starts at the foot of the cross, church. I'm getting through this. And the Lord sent you on a journey. See, God sent us on a journey after salvation. He sends you on a journey to go on unto perfection, to go on unto sanctification. And he said, go and utterly destroy the sinners and the Amalekites and fight against them until they be consumed. Wherefore, why did you not obey the voice of the Lord, but you did fly upon the spoil and you did evil in the sight of the Lord? And Saul said to Samuel, he said, yeah, I've obeyed the voice of the Lord. Oh, I've obeyed. I keep his commandments. I'm good. He said, and have I brought Agag, the king of Amalek, and I've utterly destroyed the Amalekites. He said, but the people took of the spoil and the sheep. You know, they did it. Their fault. And the chief of the things which should have been utterly destroyed, they kept it, brother, to sacrifice it to God. God don't want your flesh. He wants faith in his son, Jesus Christ. That's the only sacrifice God's going to accept. It's the only sacrifice he's going to accept. And Samuel says, does the Lord delight as much in burnt offerings and sacrifices, and you come into church and you doing good things? Does the Lord have as much desire in burnt offerings and sacrifices, listen, as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than a sacrifice, and to hearken until the fat of rams obey. Are you obeying what you're hearing? Are you applying this to your heart and letting Jesus Christ bring the change that only He can bring? Because if you're not, you're rebellious. If you're not, you're rebellious. She's cut me off on the radio, but I ain't quitting yet, because I'm going to stop when I'm done this. I'm almost finished. Listen, for rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. You know, you're acting like a witch. If you are rejecting, if you are, listen, rebelling against God's word in the face of light, rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, trying to manipulate powers of darkness. But see, you and I think we're going to manipulate the Spirit of God because we're good. And it's rebellion. Now listen. And stubbornness. Oh Lord. Stubbornness. Do you know what the word stubbornness means? I looked it up in the Hebrew and it says to push. To push. To push against truth. When Saul was on the road to Damascus, when he was confronted, Jesus said, "Why do you kick against the pricks, the goads? Why do you rebel against me?" It's hard for you to kick against, to push at, to fight against what God is trying to do in your life and think that you're going to come out to the good. Hello? I'm not telling you something I made up. I'm telling you something that my wife and I have had to learn a hard way. There's a breaking process in this. And if you don't stay in this process, you're going to become prideful. You're going to become rebellious. You're going to think you run the church. Hello? You're going to think you're it. You're going to think you're the stuff. And that you're just as good as anybody else. They don't measure up to you. And see, that's the spirit that comes from the world. Hello? I said, that's the spirit that comes from the world. Somebody said, I wish you'd hurry up and just shut up, because I've about heard enough of this. Rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. Stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. You know what idolatry is? Here, look in the self. Idolatry. Trusting in self is idolatry. You've made yourself a god. You've declared you're going to do it your own way. You've made yourself an idol out of you. God says no. It's through faith in the blood of His Son. Now listen. Here's what I want to get to. Saul said unto Samuel. So listen to this. When he gets confronted, Saul told Samuel, after Samuel confronts Saul with this, Saul says, I'm sorry. I sinned. I'm sorry. I sinned. Here's what he said. He said, I have transgressed the commandment of the Lord and your words. I sinned against you, brother. I'm sorry. Not a heartfelt, broken repentance before God in seeing his wrong, in seeing his prideful spirit, in seeing his rebellion, but, oh, I'm sorry, brother. Will you forgive me? Will you stay with me? Will you go with me in my rebellious direction? Listen, because this is what the devil wants. He wants some of y'all to go with people that are rebelling against his word. He wants you to hold hands with people that are rebelling against God's word. I love everybody, but if you're going to rebel against God's word and you think I'm going with you anywhere, you're crazy. I ain't going anywhere with you spiritually. I'm talking about in the spirit. I ain't going with you because you're heading for destruction. Listen now. Listen. I've sinned. I've transgressed the commandment of the Lord and your words because I feared the people and I obeyed their voice. It was a false repentance. Any repentance that's not under God, under Jesus Christ, with a brokenness and coming back saying, I'm sorry, I was wrong, I see now my error, it's not a repentance that God will accept. You can tell other people you're sorry, but if you don't have a brokenness before Jesus Christ, you got a false repentance. And your pride is going to take you to your destruction. Now listen, Samuel said unto Saul, listen, he said, now if therefore, Saul said, I pray you, pardon me. Oh, forgive me. But don't you know only God can forgive your sin? You're trying to get a man to forgive you when you need to be getting to Jesus Christ and asking him to forgive you? Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I don't mean to be a hindrance to the work of God. Well, good. Why don't you stop it then and surrender your old hard heart to Jesus Christ and let him bring a change in your life? Come on now. Come on now. He said, I pray, pardon my sin. And then he says this, Saul tells Samuel, turn again with me. Go with me, brother. You better hear me. You better hear me good, because here's what I come right down to get down to. Go with me, brother. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to say that. I shouldn't have done that. I shouldn't have gossiped. But there's no change. And he says, hey, go with me. Samuel says, no. Hear me now. Everybody who knows the Lord, knows God's word, knows God's way, who has discernment, this is what you're going to do. No. I'm not going with you. Take yourself. You can go with your family. You can go with people in the world. You can go with whoever you want to go with. But I'm not going with you because you're rebelling against God's word. Listen now. Hold on. I will not return with thee. For you have rejected the word of the Lord. You, me, I love people. But you and I cannot afford to be traveling down a road in the church with people who are rejecting the word of the Lord. You love people. Don't misunderstand. You love your family. But you can't go in a direction that they're going in because they're heading for destruction. Do you hear me? They're heading for destruction. You can't go with people in false religion. You can't go with people teaching things contrary to the Word of God. Do you hear me? You'll go on to your destruction. You'll go on to spiritual destruction. But now listen now. He said, I can't go with you. You've rejected the word of the Lord. And because you've rejected the word of God, he said he's rejected you from being king over Israel. God will eventually remove you from your position when you reject his word. Listen, and I'm about done, and you can breathe. And Samuel came no more to see Saul until the day of his death. He had to break away from this stubborn, prideful, religious, hard-hearted man who would not let God have his way in his heart. Listen, because the only thing at stake was a whole nation. Do you know that there's people outside the doors of this church that could be saved if you would let Jesus Christ reign supreme in your life? It affects everything. So God says, he's not going to obey me. I'm taking him out. Did you hear that? I'm taking him out. And so Samuel goes to God. He's broken. He's heartbroken. God, I don't understand. I saw you do things in his life. I saw him prophesy. I've seen your hand upon him, but God says his heart is hard. His heart is hard. And it says this, Samuel mourned for Saul And the indication is that he stayed in a place of mourning too long. Oh, God. But no. See, some of you got family members. I'm going to get personal. You got family members. You've been telling them. You've been telling them. You've been telling them. You've been telling them. They bring all their burdens to you. They make you heavier than they are. And they have rejected and rejected and rejected and rejected the word of the Lord. And you think that you're sitting around and you're mourning and you're praying is going to bring them in. It might, but not necessarily so. Because you can't make people live for God. God knows the hard heart. Do you hear me? I'm not saying you don't love your family. You don't love people outside the doors. You do. But listen, here's what God don't want. He don't want you weighed down and mourning and not carrying out His will for your life because you're sitting around pouting over your flesh, over your family, over your failures. Come on, somebody. I'm trying to get you to the good part now. I got family that's lost without God. Who don't? I remember a time I used to drive myself about nuts with some of them. Brothers, sisters. I mean, in wicked lifestyles, even some of them right now. And some of them have known God and turned their backs on Him, and they're going deeper and deeper into the pig's pen. And I made up my mind, I ain't running after nobody. I ain't going to sit around crying and mourning over people. Listen, waste my time, waste my energy with people that are stubborn, they are rebellious, they are hard-hearted, and I sure ain't going to endorse them while they're going against God's word. Come on, somebody. That don't mean I don't love them. What I got to do is stop my mourning. Come on, somebody. Some of you watching me, you've been mourning too long over some garbage that you just need to let go of. They're not going to serve God. You got to let them go. You put them in God's hands. You pray for them as the Holy Spirit leads you to. But what you need to do is get up out of your ash heap. Stop being ruled and stop being controlled by rebellious and ignorant and people that backbite, people that gossip, people that don't like your pastor, people that hate your church, and you're holding hands with them. You're going to have to break away from some people. You're just trying to control people. I'm telling you, if you're holding hands with people like this and you're trying to go with them, you're being a hindrance to the work of God. So God comes to Samuel, and I'm done here. God comes to Samuel. See, God's going to come to you. He knows what you need to hear when you need to hear it. He knew who was going to be here today. He knew who needs to hear this. He knew who's going to be watching through the internet today. And He's coming to you right now, and He's telling you something. What's He trying to tell me, Thomas? He came to Samuel and said, "How long will you mourn for Saul? How long? How long are you going to sit there? You're mourning. You're grieving. You're complaining. And God is planning bigger things than you've ever seen in your life. And He wants you to go on under sanctification. Forget it. If they don't want to go, don't worry about them. You better forget about your spouse, your house, and all this other garbage, and go on with Jesus. Whether your husband goes or whether your wife don't go. Come on, somebody. This is an individual. This is a personal decision. And you ain't going to be able to make your husband live for the Lord. You ain't going to be able to make your wife live for the Lord. What you need to do is stop mourning over them because you're being distracted from God's will. You're being distracted from seeing other lives affected. He says, stop mourning over him. Listen, he said, fill your horn with oil and go, Bubba. Stop your mourning. Now, what's the horn was a vessel that contained anointing oil. Can I tell you today, you're a horn? You're supposed to be. You're supposed to be the vessel in which the Holy Ghost resides on the inside. You're supposed to be overflowing with the power and the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Don't you tell me you can't when God says you can. Don't you tell me you can't move beyond your past. Put your faith in the blood of Jesus Christ. Get filled with the Holy Ghost, brother, and get up out of your mourning. Get up out of your pity party. Get up out of your rebellion. Get up out of your unbelief and get going, because God's got somebody else waiting in the wings, honey, that's going to carry out his will. Come on, somebody. This is good news. Stop mourning. Get filled with the Holy Ghost and go. And let me tell you something. If you don't get filled with the Holy Ghost, you ain't going nowhere. I said, if you don't get filled, if you don't let the Holy Spirit fill your vessel up, you ain't getting up out of nothing and you ain't going anywhere. Stop mourning. Fill your vessel with oil. Are you filled with the Holy Ghost this morning? And go. Go. God says, go. Go forward. Get out of your ash heap, Job. Get up and go. Hello? This is good news this morning. I got you to the hard part. I got you to the good part now. Stop mourning. Get filled. And you can only be filled with the Holy Spirit by yielding yourself to the power of Jesus Christ. If you won't yield yourself to the power of Jesus Christ, you won't be filled with the Holy Spirit. Won't work. Don't happen like that. You refuse to yield, you don't get filled. You can't carry out the commandment of the Lord partially. You can't get filled with the Holy Spirit without tongues. That's partial. Jimmy? The evidence you've been filled is speaking with other tongues. Get filled with the Holy Spirit and go. Stop mourning. The Lord's telling somebody today. Some of you, you about drove yourself crazy with some people. This message is for me too. Because I made up my mind, I ain't mourning over people that are rejecting God's word. I ain't going to do it. I'm not going with them. I love them. I ain't going to mistreat them. But I ain't going with them. I'm getting full of the Holy Ghost. We fixing to go to Africa. I ain't mourning for anybody. We're getting filled with the Holy Ghost. We're leaving for Africa, honey. And we're going to go and we're going to carry out the work of the Lord. We're going to carry out the word of the Lord. And we're going to come back filled, overflowing with the power of the Holy Ghost. Do you hear me? I ain't going mourning. I ain't going to go. And I wonder what's... when I leave out of here, I'm putting my mind away from this church. Whatever happens is going to happen. But I can tell you right now, the devil ain't going to run this church. He ain't coming in this church to distract this church. He ain't using no gossiping tongues. So you can stay home if you ain't thinking about it. Because we got some people set in place in this church that if you start acting like a devil, you're going to be removed. Hello. Because God is in control of this church. Boy, he just controls people. He just likes to control people. We are the pastors of this church, and we don't let devils come in and try to steal what God is doing. I'm an overseer. I watch. And when I see a devil, I say, pow! There he is. You know what you do when you step on a snake's head real hard? He squirms. Kind of like some Christians when they get stepped on. And they get the feelings hurt and they get under conviction. Man, I've seen them about tear a pew down. Gripping it. Gripping it. Got to have control. I'm done. I saw the Holy Spirit moving in a funeral. You can stand on your feet. I saw God moving in a funeral home one day, dealing with one of my family members. I had to preach this funeral of my half-sister. And boy, you talk about hard. Died of a drug overdose. And I had family there. I had a half-brother sitting on the front seat of that funeral home, and I preached, and the Spirit of God hit that place so strong, and that man squeezed that pew so hard, and he was gripping, he was fighting. You could see it all over him to not come and give his heart to the Lord.
Boy, that's just awful, Thomas. Well, hold on. What about you? You haven't been guilty of holding back, have you? You haven't been guilty of just surrendering all to Jesus, have you? Stop mourning. Get filled and go. Come on, Michaela. Come on, Grace. I don't really even know how to give this altar call today except to say this. If there's something that you need to surrender to God today, your heart, here's what you need to do. You need to humble yourself. Humble. He told Saul, when you were little in your own sight, when you weren't prideful, when you weren't trying to take control of your own life, when you stopped trying to do it on your own, and you submitted to Jesus Christ, and you were humble, God began to work in you. And if you're here this morning, and there's something that you need to let the Spirit of God deal with, rebellion, unbelief, pride, jealousy, envy. Look, the list can go on and on and on. I don't care what it is, but I'm going to ask you to make a bold move. This altar's open. I didn't say your seat is open. I said this altar is open. And if there's something that you need to bring to God today, bring to the Lord. I know this has been a tough message. I know it is. But I'm telling you, we need it. This altar is open. Pour your heart out to the Lord today. Pour your heart out to the Lord today. Listen, there's things in us, folks, that needs to be driven out. It can only be driven out by the power of the Holy Spirit. It can only be driven out by the power of the Holy Spirit. The burdens of my soul rolled away. It's at the cross, church. Your answer is found in the blood of Jesus Christ. Your answer is found in the blood of God's Son. That's where your answer is found. And if you'll come today and throw yourself on the mercy of God, He will restore you. He will work in you. He'll do whatever needs to be done in you today. Let Him touch you where you are. Hallelujah. Praise God. Michael, would you come and help pray for some people? Piece of wood. I'm talking about a surrender. I'm talking about a place of death. A place of death where the old man has to die. There can't be any remnants of that old man left. Only Jesus can crucify and eliminate that old man. Come on, just begin to praise Him, church. Just begin to praise Him. Thank Him today for the word that you've heard. Thank Him today that you've heard the truth. And the truth is making you free today. That you're leaving here today a different person.
individual. You're leaving a different person because you're going to apply what you've heard today. At the cross, at the cross.
At the cross.
Praise God. Come on, church. At the foot of the cross,
there by faith, I receive my sight, and now I am.
We pray you were blessed by this live service from Family Worship Center in Athens, Tennessee. Join us for our live services held Sunday morning at 11 a.m., Sunday evening at 6 p.m., Wednesday evening at 7 p.m., and our Saturday morning Bible study at 9 a.m. Eastern Time. If this program has been a blessing to you, or if you have any questions, please visit our website at www.fwc-tn.com.